stop.
Yeah. I'll tell her to listen to the music. Yeah.
So the evening, and on behalf of the Brahmakumari Interstate Meditation Center and Gallery, I'd like to welcome you to this evening's program. Our special guest tonight has come all the way from London, Mike George. And as many of you may know, that Mike's a very acclaimed author of a variety of books, including a book on the title that we're going to be talking about tonight, which is Don't Get Mad, Get Wise. In addition to that, his books include The Seven Ahas, A Light for Enlightened Soul. His newest book is The Immune System of the Soul. And Mike has traveled around, the world, actually giving talks about the work that he has discovered, by writing these books. So we're very lucky to have him with us tonight. In addition to being a well-known author, he's also a speaker, an inspirational speaker, and he does a lot of coaching for people with a personal level, and also works with corporations and helping them to,
No.
The mic keeps going on. So he's working with corporations as well as individuals in executive development and personal development. But what I'd like to do is I'd like to take just a minute to share with you my own affiliation with Mike. I had the privilege of meeting him back in 1989. And at that time, both he and I were working on an international project. And we met, I was introduced to him at a meeting that we were having down in the United Nations. And to this day, I can remember when Mike came up to me and he introduced himself. And I looked at him and I said, that's so interesting. He's got the gleam in his eye of a child. And he's just like a little kid, And so then, after that, over the next 20 some odd years, I would see Mike. And I would see Mike maybe two or three times a year, sometimes in London, sometimes in India, sometimes here in the United States. And I was, I would watch him grow and change, but the one thing that never left Mike was that gleam in his eye. And so as he comes up and he speaks with us this evening, I hope you're going to enjoy him. And you just watch. He's got a gleam that we all need to catch. So please join me in welcoming Mike.
Thank you.
What are you guys doing with sound? What are you plugging in?
A little bit about me, about my journey to this point, because it kind of puts the evening in context in terms of why I'm talking about this particular subject. I'm really not here to teach you anything, but just to share a few insights. And maybe those insights might be useful to you in terms of understanding why occasionally you get a little mad. Do you ever get a little mad?
No.
Yeah? Actually, it's a silly question, because otherwise you wouldn't be here. Occasionally you get a little irritated or frustrated, because those are the early warning signs, aren't they, of madness, irritation, and frustration. And I woke up about 32 years ago, really in quite an irritated state, and I call it stress, basically. I was really stressed out. That crept up on me for many years. And it creeps up on most people very slowly, and we just kind of learn to tolerate it until it becomes so strong we have to do something about it. And that was my experience. I woke up one day and I realized I have to change something, I have to do something different. So I went to look outside and inside to see what I had to change in my own life. And very quickly I began to realize the one thing no one ever teaches us. In fact, I've been around the world over the past 30 years, I don't think there's any society that teaches anyone one particular subject, which is not an academic subject, but it's the most important subject, and it's called self-understanding. And the reason why it's kind of important is that if I don't understand me, then I can't manage me. That really means managing my thoughts, my feelings, my emotions, my attitude towards others. If I can't manage those things within me, then I can't manage the stuff around me very well, like my relationships and responsibilities and my resources. And every day, what do you do every day? You get to play many different roles every day. And I realized, actually, I've forgotten how to play. In fact, not just play, but create. Because if you think about your life, you could play and create as many roles as you want. Is that true? I think so. We tend to get locked into one or two, but actually we can play as many roles, create as many roles as we want. And I woke up one day and realized, actually, life is really very playful and very creative. But what do? We take it all so seriously. And you know how seriously you're taking it? When you look in the mirror and you see that slightly long face in the morning, you know that long face you see in the morning? You know, the horse walks into the bar and the barman says to the horse, "Why the long face?" And my life had become increasingly long face, and that's also a sign of stress, which is really unhappiness. Unhappiness and stress, they go hand in hand together. And I forgot, actually, that life is just a game. Life is a game, and we are here to play. We're here to play. Is that true? Does that make sense? And it's just that to play now, we tend to need to have some kind of stimulation in order to be playful. We forgot how to be naturally playful in our life. It's okay, we're okay with this. Okay, that's enough. Is that working? Okay, is that better at the back?
Yeah.
It's funny, isn't it? Mike always has trouble with the mic. Is that? So, what I did is I started to look around to see what it is I could do differently to free myself from my stress. I always share this little story. One day I was looking at the International Bible of All-Known Wisdom, otherwise known as the Yellow Pages. I picked up the Yellow Pages, and I was looking for some, you know, exercise and relaxation. And I saw an entry called the Paja Yoga Center. I thought, Paja Yoga, that sounds like pajama yoga. I've heard of it before, but it sounded like fun. And I phoned the Paja Yoga Center, and it was a misprint. It should have been the Raja Yoga Center. And in fact, that's who's organized tonight's program. As many of you will know, the BK, the Brahma Kumaris, is their founding term. they run Raja Yoga centers throughout the world. And Raja Yoga is basically a method of meditation. And I have not really been interested in meditation up until that point. And I was prepared to try anything. You know those moments when you try anything to get relief from some kind of pain? Yeah, you try, you know, massage and foot baths and head baths and pills and potions. And so I was going to try anything. So I went to the Raja Yoga Center to learn how to meditate. And I sat down to meditate for the very first time. I didn't understand what I was doing. It was kind of in one ear and out the other, all the theory. But when I actually meditated, I felt very deeply peaceful within myself. And that was the opposite end of the spectrum to the stressfulness that I'd been creating for myself. And so I really recognized I need to build this meditation into my life. And so that's what I did from that day onwards, and I began to practice meditation as I worked in a very busy lifestyle, very busy job. And then a few years later, I started teaching, coaching, training, lecturing, and so on. So that's a little bit about me and what kind of has me sitting here sharing, I guess, a little bit about why we do get a bit stressed, a bit mad occasionally. But before I go to that territory, before I take you on a little bit of a journey, just might be nice, especially for me, just to have a couple of moments of quietness. And maybe I could invite you just to join me in whatever way you're comfortable, whether it's meditation or contemplation or reflection. Hands up those here who are already practicing meditators, as a matter of interest. Ah, wow, many of you, goodness me, preaching to the converted. Fantastic. But then you'll know that many people try meditation, but they give up very quickly. And many people try. But I always say most people have tried meditation, but they give up fast. And there's two reasons for that. Number one, expectation. We live in the age of expectation, and we expect instant results in anything that we do. So when we sit to meditate, we expect to feel deeply, deeply peaceful, almost instantly, because that's what it says, chapter 3 in the book. We expect light to go off, and to sit and meditate and then to stand up and be enlightened, because that's what it says in chapter 5. Meditation will make you enlightened. And so we expect instantly results. And when nothing happens, what do we think? Doesn't work. Yeah, doesn't work for me. Or I'm not very good at this. It must be me. I'll try again later. Try again later. In actual fact, when nothing happens, that's the sign of success. Because the purpose of meditation is for nothing to happen. Funny, isn't it? But it's a bit strange for us because everything we do, we expect results. In other words, something to happen. We expect to feel something or something to stimulate. And that's quite strange when nothing happens. And so, oh, something's not right here. I'm feeling as if there's nothing. But actually, that's the purpose, is to bring quietness and stillness and peace back into our consciousness so that nothing is happening. And the second reason why people kind of find it difficult is there's two steps I have to do first before I meditate. And step number one is relax, relaxation basically. I need to consciously relax the energy of my body so it doesn't distract me. I need to consciously relax my mind so it doesn't interrupt me. And it won't be totally relaxed, but I need to begin to talk to my mind, because in meditation you begin to notice you are not your mind. You have a mind, but it's not you. And so the practice of meditation is restoring mastery over your mind. So I just need to give it permission to relax. And then balanced with that is something called concentration, relaxation, concentration.
And you might think, well, it's easy to concentrate. But if I ask you to hold your attention on this plant over here, and don't let your attention stray, just concentrate gently on the plant, you would probably get to the count of 6, 7, maybe 8, and guess what would happen? Your attention would stray. Because we also live in the age of distraction. And this is the age of distraction. Every day you wake up, your attention is up for auction. The moment you walk out into the world, there's 1,000 people trying to hook your attention. Because if they believe, if they can hook your attention, they'll get into your pocket. And so we're kind of addicted to being distracted by all these messages of people wanting to get our attention. So concentration is not quite so easy. When I say concentration, I don't mean all of it concentrate, but concentrate, concentrate, all of it concentrate. I don't mean that kind of concentration. I mean the ability to hold my attention gently on one thing, either outside or inside. And then when my attention strays, just to come back and start again. When it goes, to come back and start again. It's actually, it's a little bit of practice for most of us. So I'm relaxed and concentrating. Not too relaxed, or guess what? Hands on those who fall asleep as soon as you start meditating. So it's a shame that sleep is not meditation. And so the secret is, don't fight it. If you feel sleep coming on, go to sleep. It's just that if you're in a room with others, try not to snore. Because it's a little bit disturbing. But do go to sleep. You all know what a power nap is? You know what a power nap is? Did anyone, any of you power nap? 10 minutes? It's like a night's sleep, isn't it? Fantastic. And then when you wake up, then is the time to practice your meditation. Then not too concentrated, otherwise there's too much tension. So this balance between relaxation and concentration, and then you're centered in a place called equipoise, you're centered there, and then I go into the meditative state. It's not rocket science really, it's just to begin with, as I start to practice, I need to just do these two things first, and then have absolutely no expectations. Never measure your experience against anyone else's. Never expect to experience anything specific. And never try to repeat an experience you've already had. These are the kind of the secrets of getting started here. So maybe I can invite you just to join me for a moment. This is as much for me as it is for us all. It kind of helps me get centered and communicate clearly with you. So if you want to just take the shape of your chair for a moment, just take the shape of your chair. You're a bit slouched in the chair. And just bring the body up to a kind of, you know, it doesn't have to be tense and tight, but, you know, you're kind of alertish with your physical energy. And then, you've seen these scanners on TV. Just take your awareness down to your toes and scan your body. If you take nothing away from tonight, then this is a nice little relaxation exercise. And just scan your body with your awareness and see if you can find any tension or tightness anywhere in your body. And if you do find some tension, then just let it go. Don't force it to relax. Just look at it and allow it to relax. And then bring your awareness to your breath. And just be aware of your breathing for a moment. And just follow your breath. Don't force it, but just watch the complete movement of your breath. Gently concentrating on your breath. As you watch, you become a little more relaxed. And then bring your awareness to yourself. And just take a moment and and see if you can be aware of yourself being aware. Then within your awareness, just create one thought, one simple thought. I am the being of peace. I am the being of peace. Allow that thought to grow gently in your mind. Tension strains away, just come back and start again. And then let that thought fade away, let it dissolve into the background. And notice what remains. There's a subtle feeling. There's a peacefulness here where I am. The mind is gone. And there's a stillness here at the heart of your being. Bring your awareness back. Back to your body, to the chair, the room around you. To the here and now. Bring that stillness with you. Bring that peace, which is you. Bring that with you. In the space of a few moments, just by using your thoughts, you can restore your peace, you can restore your strength on the inside. And if you practice that two or three times a day, I guarantee it makes a difference. It makes a difference to your energy level, makes a difference to the quality of your thinking. Makes a difference to the energy you give to others. And you know they will say, what you give is what you get. So it's just a little exercise. It's very simple. You can do it anytime, anywhere. just don't be in the car on the way home. We're of course not here to explore this, but we're kind of here to explore why we're not to be so easily, basically. And I guess what I remember most is about 3 or 4 years ago in the UK, one of the big Sunday newspapers, one of the magazines, the Sunday supplement magazines, he did this huge survey. And it was not just the UK, it was international. We've begun to recognize that the levels of anger in the world were going up, generally, almost in every area of society. So they did a big survey, and they published the results of the survey, and they called the result of the survey, "We Live in the Age of Rage." We live in the age of rage. And they found that amazing statistics about the rising levels of anger in professional life. I think it was something like 43% of neighbors will spend more than 2 years fighting with each other. Maybe that's unique to the UK, maybe it doesn't happen here so much. They found that road rage levels were rising in all sorts of areas of society. And they went on to find the cause. Why were people becoming angrier than at any other time? And they boiled it down to two things. The first one, I've already mentioned actually, is expectation. And the second reason was speed. Hello? Am I meant to do something? Is that one of these switches again? It's good, thank you. So the two things were expectation and speed. And we live in the age of expectation. I don't know about you, but where I come from, you can go anywhere almost any time of year. You can fly anywhere in the world for £1. Almost £1. Do you have that here? No, you don't have that here. You have these airlines and you can get a ticket to go anywhere almost in Europe for £1 or £2, almost instantly. And so we're the generation who can have anything almost instantly. You can go home tonight and you can take that little mouse on your desk and with two clicks you can have anything in the world fall through your letterbox in the space of, well, probably even the next day. And if you think about it, that is like the power of the gods. The manifestation through technology of whatever you want almost instantly. And we've been getting used to that over the past 10, 15, 20 years of having our expectations instantly met with great speed. And of course, when they surveyed the rising levels of anger, they saw that the reason most people get angry is that their expectations are not being met fast enough. And if you think about it, what is an expectation? It's a form of desire. And if you just take a moment to be aware, you'll notice that whenever you desire something, you already have it. Where? In your, you notice that? When you want something, you already have it. And then there's the expectation that it will show up in material reality very quickly. And when it doesn't show up, or when someone gets in the way, that's when we get a little bit, begin to have irritation. Yeah, when someone doesn't do what you want, doesn't come in the door at the right time, doesn't lay the table in the right way, doesn't put the vase on the shelf in exactly the right position. Those little expectations, and we get a little irritated. And irritation is like the seed. And it's like if you water a seed, it grows. So if you water irritation, it grows into frustration. becomes frustration. And if you water the frustration, in other words, if you give it the energy of your attention, you keep thinking about it, in other words, that's what energy is, the energy of your thinking, your attention, it grows into anger. And if you keep watering the anger, it grows into rage. And then murder is just around the corner. You have a bit of road rage here, occasionally? Does that happen here sometimes? We have a new rage where I come from. It's not road rage, it's trolley rage. Yeah? It's supermarket. And people run around the supermarket, and one of the reasons is the aisles are getting narrower, so you bump into people, and people are going faster, because they've got to get through the shopping quicker, because they expect to be able to get it all done in the quickest space of time, because they can go and do something else. And so, they bump into each other a lot more. And so, you know, so this is a process by which just those little seeds of expectation not being met becomes irritation, frustration, anger, and suddenly I'm in a rage. And the process itself, actually, well, if you think about it, when you expect or want anything, you know, it's like I want that new house. Yeah, in fact, I don't just want it. I can see myself in the new house, and the kitchen's going to be gorgeous, and the lounge.